and Tavor has written in rhyme and is meant to be playful and childlike. Overall, you know, World War I was pretty much a bummer and a downer, so it's true. I have, there's a couple pieces, there's a number of pieces in here about women. As I started doing my research, I really thought what I had initially was a bunch of stories about white Anglo-Saxon and Protestant males. And I thought, I need to tell the rest of the stories that aren't about those kind of people. So I kept looking and digging. And I found Sandra Dorothy Lawrence, whose soldierly career as an undercover journalist was cut short when she got sick. And she said she was threatened by the British War Office. She eventually wrote a book called Sapper Dorothy Lawrence, the Only English Woman Soldier, and it did well internationally, but it was heavily censored by the War Office. So she eventually was reported to have some mental issues, and she confided to a doctor. She was raped by her church guardian, so we have a Me Too story here. And she was deemed insane, committed to an asylum for the rest of her life. And I can't help but think that she was probably railroaded somewhere in there. So anyway, Sapper Dorothy Lawrence. An orphan with a dream, the original stunt journalist, forbidden by French police. No, mademoiselle journaliste. In effect, they told you it takes balls. And you wondered what it would take for a woman to get into the army. What would it be like? With the help of 10 khaki accomplices, a man's haircut, a razored face, a shoe-polished tan, a tight corset doing no wonders for a girlish figure, cotton batting for shoulders, and lessons on drilling and marching, you passed as Private Dennis Smith, Leicester Regiment, for 10 days in the summer of 1915. So technically, fake media. You were threatened by the War Office, ordered not to publish. Your eventual book is an international hit, but heavily censored. It would have been an Amazon bestseller. What a bold woman. Put that in your Kindle. They can't take that away from you. Later, you would be long institutionalized, but not forgotten. Okay, put your heart in here. While you guys were talking, but you were doing such a good job, I was paying close attention. So. The social media sphere then. They're out there still, wherever little messages go. Terse scribbles from World War I, as if farm boys, doughboys, fly boys, nurses, clawed smartphones, hollered back 10 decades later to Twitter followers, time travel on steampunk cells. Home folks anxiously intercepting or retweeting Instagram posts when instead of checking for Wi-Fi, their young men scan for snipers. The ringtone of their generation, when Johnny comes marching home, looking around, or the Colonel Bogey march from the depths of dugouts, set it on silent when they slip over the top, lest a sniper hear and hone in on their heart. A full century after the Great War, behind pale gravestones, ghosts on the former Western Front hold spectral limbs out and snap selfies in French and German, Belgian cemeteries after visiting hours, post or retweet their tweets with all the abbreviations and hashtags of the social media generation. No email, no tinny voice messages on speaker or Bluetooth. Instead, in drawers, in trunks, amidst time-dulled metals, those are their computer chips, loaded with data. Old service records. We can read their posts, encapsulating things that don't die. The obscenity of war, the ferocity of a parent's love, the abomination that is a child dying before his grandparent. Smell the TNT, hear the whistle of the shell's arc, feel the panic slip in the mud underfoot. Hashtag that. I think, do I have time for one more? Okay, this is called A Little Town of Our Home. And if you're familiar with Christian Christmas songs, A Little Town of Bethlehem, you might hear some strains of that in here. So in Britain, there was a fellow who noticed, about 20 years after the war, he noticed when he started separating all the facts that there were some villages that every guy they sent came back alive. And he called them thankful villages. Oh, little town of Arkholm, how blessed with returning sons you are. Arthur Mee noted the rarity and named you a thankful village. You sent 59 of your best sons, fathers, brothers, sweethearts, to face the war monster, and every last man, all 59, returned home, safe, but not necessarily unchanged, escaping the law of an eye for an eye. Think of it, happy coincidence, fucking probabilities, all who go come back. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the entire war goes by, twilight zone unbreakable. Insurance bean counters mightn't have predicted it. How silently this wondrous gift is given. The hopes and fears of all the war years as mothers, fathers, and sweethearts held their collective lucky breath. Did they pray, drum fingers? Did they cultivate ulcers and twitches? Bookmakers might pause at the odds of a handful of towns with this phenomenon. A cynic might say, buy a lottery ticket, and wonder about rates and dates of volunteerism versus conscription. Yet in thy blackout dark streets shineth no need for survival guilt, considering all everyone was subjected to, like the rest of us whose grandfathers returned. Home, but not unscathed, different for all they had seen. We too are thankful villages, those of us who had one veteran at a time return to brighten their families' doorways. Not untouched, still different. Tears are due for those whose losses were more bitter, but we rejoice with you on the blissful statistical anomaly that shaped your town's DNA, and wonder if your communal lucky streak continued, and if it was something in the water. Thank you. Misery or loss or something like that. It's usually someone who's miserable and someone who lost something. So I have something funny that I do. Stuff occurs to me all the time, Facebook, news stories, everything. It just jumps out at me. It's like, oh, there's poetry in here, there's stories in here, there's a novel in here. Those are the most undeliverable of the inclinations. But so what I do is I file it using SEO words to get my attention later. So I'll copy and paste it. Because if I tried to keep it in a journal, the journal would be like this big, right? So what I do is I copy the thing that's interesting to me and I paste it into an email. And then I put little keywords, and there's like three secret keywords. So if you're ever digging through, you know, I don't want everything that has to do with loss or cars, but if I put this three secret, you know, alligator, sunshine, misfit, and then a couple, then that helps me. So then later when I'm looking for novel ideas, I go for alligator, sunshine, misfit, novel, and all those ideas pop up in my emails. So that's my own personal treasure trove of stuff, right? Wow. Yeah, so there's no shortage of ideas. I don't work as much with pen and paper as I would love to. I think that's a really great way to do it. I get impatient, I think, too fast. My mind races too much, and so there's all, you know, the clack-clack drives my husband absolutely start raving crazy. Clack-clack, are you clack-clacking again? Yes, I'm clack-clacking. So anyway, yeah, that's basically how I work. So this book started, the process for it started with my aunt saying, look, Jackie, I've never looked at them, but here are my dad's journals and letters from World War I. And I'm like, what? So you are always the one who's asking questions about family. And mostly I wanted to know why my mom and father was so cranky and difficult and an absolute bastard. And so I was really pleased to find something that I could maybe look through and find out, learn more about him. I found out he was like this really charming guy who wrote all these letters to a woman he was enamored with, who happened to be a writer, and she mentioned him in a couple of her books, and she kept all of his letters. He didn't keep hers, I don't know what happened. You know, soldiers, they they probably don't have room for a handful of letters. But anyway, yeah, she kept them. And she eventually gave them to CDC. They did like a half-hour program on them. And then they made it back to the family fold, and then I got these photo copies of them, plus these little journals and stuff. The sad thing is that the journals are disappearing. Like, they're written, a lot of it is in pencil, right? And it's, you know, you open it up and it's like, okay, either I'm like going blind or I can't read this as well as I could 5 years ago. So that's kind of sad. But I'm glad that I went through them and that I wrote them on my own, right? And kept them. So basically, honestly, at the start of this year, I realized I have all this stuff that I'd done a project on Twitter where I pretended I was my grandfather and I was tweeting. In 2012, oh, that's century of data. In 2012, I did this project where, and I was trying to get reach out to the next generation. I thought, wouldn't that be fun, right? So here's this guy tweeting. And it turns out there was a lot of people doing this, mostly after I did it, but as the anniversaries of the war started rolling up in 2014, 2015, more people started doing it. So if you look, you can find lots of tweets from about World War I. So that was very fun. So I had that, and I had other interviews and stories that I've done about World War I, and I realized I have a book. I don't have time to pitch it to a conventional publisher. I'm going to have to just go. And Cynthia, you know, heard me commiserating. I did this whole thing myself. I even designed the cover in PowerPoint. I didn't have my copy of the design with me, so I was just desperate to get it out. And it was super fun to do. And so it's self-published. Anybody have any questions about my process?
I like you say it's an incredible research job that you've done here. It's a marvelous book. Like I said, I think it should be in the schools. I was wondering, can you articulate whether or not this has changed you doing this whole book? And did you find any manner of peace doing it?
Yeah, I got a lot more respect for my grandfather, seeing all the stuff that he'd gone through, and finding out on Facebook other people posting stuff about that generation stuff. Really, and then going and actually walking on the Western Front myself was like illuminating. And then I realized, you know, my dad was terrible, but his father had been really cruel to him. What made his father cruel to him would probably make anybody go start raving crazy. So, yes, I'd say so.
Well, was he in the second one?
Who?
Your dad?
No, he was 4F and he was so PO'd because the World War I was always this thing that had given Grandpa never talked about it, but he had these friends and he had this camaraderie and he had these medals, and Dad wanted to go so much, and he was flat-footed and he had rickets, and he had bad eyesight in one eye, so he looked perfectly fine, but they were like, no, I won't take it.
Yeah. Has this itch sort of come out as a novel, or has it wanted to come out as a novel? Or do you prefer the mixed genre?
I love the mixed genre. Yeah. And it's kind of weird because I have poetry fans. Yvonne Blomer wrote a blurb for my cover, and she said, okay, it's not poetry. I love it, I adore it, but it's not really technically poetry. Sort of journalism poetry, it's geometry. You know. I do have a novel that is almost finished, so I can't really start another one, I feel, until I actually finish that one. I workshopped it with the writer's studio, and that was a really interesting process, the online one, and that's where Cindy and I met. So, yeah. Any other questions? So I get a little bit of time to talk about something, anything, like anything? Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. This coming weekend in Victoria, there's this really cool thing called the Connection Project, and it's poetry and arts and music. And it's this big mishmash, but it's got a theme. My friend Daniel Olson, who was in also the writer's studio with me, is organizing it, and it's all about mental illness and dealing with mental illness and establishing a dialogue about it and talking about it and destigmatizing it. It's fantastic. It's unique. It's really fabulous. And I have to design the program for it tomorrow, so I'm going to be like super busy. But anyway, it's wonderful. So it's in Victoria at the Mary Winspear thing. And I just think it's so brave and cool of her to do that because of her own journey and because of those friends. And we all are somewhere on the mental health spectrum at any given time. I think we talked about that earlier, right? Federation of BC Writers is a member of that, and we really want to make connections with Prince George, actually. And so I'm hoping to establish a dialogue with you. And you're going to come. I'm so excited the other day has come out of it. I'm involved with Bernie Valley Words on Fire, and I also organize workshops there for writers. And we're always excited to bring resources in. Cynthia's been a presenter and a workshop presenter. Fabulous. So I'm hoping we'll have that program there very soon. So without further ado, thank you very much.
Thank you.